Let me take you back in time, to a place without the wonders of the modern world. 500 years ago the earth was dark, a place of mystery and superstition. But then science changed everything. This series will tell the stories of the British scientists who changed the world. We have asked some of the great scientists and inventors of today to tell us about their heroes.
Now let's start her up.
It opened up a whole new world of the very small.
Kate, was Thompson's big idea.
The moon hunter is a true hero.
Exciting possibility.
He made science in Britain really matter.
Britain has a tremendous scientific legacy that most people know little about. We want to set the record straight and put science back on the map.
The world is full of wonders, but they become more wonderful when science looks at them.
Our story began with a handful of young men who gazed up at the sky and discovered the underlying laws of the universe. The generation which followed was just as extraordinary. Recorded here together in this group portrait, a crowded room full of brilliant minds. We want to tell you about six of them. Each of us has our favorites. From the son of a boat builder, to the richest man in England. From a country doctor, to a charismatic adventurer. At a time when there was no electric light, disease killed countless thousands, and most people knew little of the world beyond Britain's borders. These six men would use science to save lives, generate power, and allow man to fly for the first time. Between them they would transform the world and take science from the abstract to the practical.
My man is the great Sir Joseph Banks, gentleman amateur naturalist, president of the Royal Society for over 40 years and founder of a tradition of scientific exploration that was ultimately to lead to Charles Darwin.
Here he is in the engraving as an old man, right at the heart of the scientific world. Lauded in his own time, today he's little remembered. To me, he's an unsung hero, the founding father of a tradition of scientific expeditions which would have a massive impact on both Britain and the world.
As a boy, Joseph Banks was a keen collector of insects and birds' eggs. But the story goes that he found his true vocation one afternoon when he was 15, and he went for a swim in the Thames near Eton. And as he got out, he was suddenly overwhelmed by the beauty of the wildflowers on the bank. He determined there and then he would become a botanist.
And he was in the fortunate position to have the money to pursue his dream. When Banks went up to Oxford, he employed a tutor from Cambridge specially to teach him botany. This display of initiative and confidence, no doubt helped by breeding and wealth, was to characterise Banks' approach to learning and getting things done. After his father's death, the young Joseph Banks inherited several estates and a vast fortune.
And what he did with it was quite extraordinary. Instead of setting off on the usual grand tour of Europe, he arranged to join Captain Cook, who was preparing to set off for the Pacific to find the recently discovered island of Tahiti on the other side of the world.
Tahiti already had a thrilling reputation as an island paradise populated by noble savages and beautiful, friendly women. But the scientific purpose of the expedition was to observe the transit of the planet Venus across the disk of the Sun, a rare astronomical event. The measurement would help calculate the distance between the Earth and the Sun, and that would help in calculating longitude, essential for accurate navigation and in turn for the extension of British sea power. For Banks, it was a wonderful opportunity to discover just how varied animals and plants were outside Europe. By the mid-18th century, Britain's horizons had changed. She had colonies and trading posts in America, Africa, and India. This fueled an intense desire to explore, collect, and classify the wonders of the world, from shells to beetles and flowers to fossils. So Banks's imminent voyage was causing great excitement in the salons. He was already well connected and well known. Now he was going where few men had gone before, and who could tell what he might find there? He insisted on taking with him 8 companions and 2 greyhounds. But Captain Cook's ship, the Endeavour, was only 100 feet long, and it was already overcrowded. It had a crew of 85, astronomers, together with their equipment, stores for 18 months at sea, a goat, and the ship's cat. Navy rules allowed each sailor only 14 inches of hammock space. Captain Cook's great cabin was only 12 feet square, but he would have to share it with Banks and 2 of his entourage, their scientific equipment, as well as all the specimens of fish, mammals, birds, and plants that they would collect along the way. Uncomfortable, yes, but also extremely dangerous. As Dr. Johnson put it, a ship is like a jail with the added risk of being drowned. But apart from shipwreck, there was also the danger from scurvy and other diseases, and fatal encounters with natives in unknown savage lands. And indeed, of Banks's party of 8, only 3 would return alive. The Endeavour set sail from Plymouth on the 25th of August 1768, bound for the South Pacific and immortality. It would be 3 years before Banks saw England again. And he would come back with a huge booty of new specimens. These would capture the attention of the public and the king and help Banks take science from the interest of the privileged few to an activity at the heart of the nation's pride and success.
But while Banks and Cook were away on their voyage to Tahiti, back in Britain, a more humble man was dreaming of something so radical that it would transform the landscape of Britain, and then the world.